So good morning everyone. I am Dr. Shantini, assistant professor, department of anatomy. Today's class is on radiological and surface anatomy of the lower limb. So first we will see about the radiological anatomy. So overview of today's class, it is introduction about the radiological and surface anatomy, standard views taken in the radiograph and types of the radiograph, appearance of a normal skeleton and radiological appearance of regions of the lower limb, that is the three regions, hip region, knee region, ankle and foot region. And also finally we conclude with the uses of the plain x-ray of the lower limb. So introduction. So what is radiological anatomy? It is a study of anatomy of human body using x-rays. Then what do you mean by radiography? Imaging technique using x-rays, gamma rays, etc. to view the internal form of an object. So to view the internal form of a living individual, we use this technique, which we call it as a radiography. Then what is a radiograph? It is just a photographic image produced on a photosensitive surface by the x-ray radiation. Radiograph, it is an essential element in clinical diagnosis. So it helps in the confirmation of the diagnosis in clinical setup. X-rays. Who discovered X-rays? It was discovered by Roentgen in 1895 and it is a part of an electromagnetic spectrum. So it has a low, shorter wavelength, 1 in 10,000 of the wavelength of the visible light. So this property, that is a shorter wavelength property, makes the X-ray to penetrate through the materials. So penetrating effect. What is a penetrating effect? X-rays are, when they pass through a subject, when they pass through a material object, partly it is absorbed and partly it is scattered. So higher the atomic weight or density, greater the absorption. So it depends upon how much amount absorbed. A substance or a material absorbing how much amount of radiation depends upon its atomic weight and the density. So this is a fundamental property to obtain an image. For example, bone. Bone, it has a higher, we all know, it has high calcium content. So it is denser than skin and muscle. That is why bone is denser. That is, it will look more white or radio opaque than skin and muscles, which are radiolucent. Structures easily penetrated by X-rays, or they appear radiolucent, that is they appear black, whereas structures which are not penetrated or which are penetrated little by the X-rays, they appear in the X-ray as radio opaque, which we call it as appear as white. So now you see, this is a chest X-ray, so where you can see both the radio opaque and the structures, radio opaque and radiolucent. So here lungs, it appears radiolucent, whereas your bones, they appear radio opaque. So this is how white and black color of an X-rays. So hereafter we should not use white and black, we should use the terminology radiolucent and radio opaque. So what are the standard views X-rays are taken? So based on the location of the X-ray tube and the photographic film plate. So X-ray, we call it as a postero-anterior view. So this is the standard view, postero-anterior view, which means the source of the X-ray tube, you see here, the source of the X-ray tube is on the posterior aspect, whereas the photographic film or the X-ray film will be anterior to the patient. Okay, so this view is called as the postero-anterior view. So this is a X-ray tube and this is a film plate. So this tabular column shows the different views taken in an X-ray and how they are named. So anteroposterior view means the X-ray tube will be in the front and the photographic film in the back. Postero-anterior means this is the most common view taken. X-ray tube will be back and the photographic film will be in front. Lateral view, it can be right lateral or left lateral. Oblique, so if this oblique view is taken to visualize special structures like your left atrium. So right anterior, left anterior oblique, your heart chambers. So to visualize the heart chambers, we use this oblique view. So how to locate the orientations? So orientation of an X-ray film, which is the right side, which is the left side of the X-ray. So this can be marked by a lead letter. So in the X-ray film, in the top of the X-ray film, either on the right or left, you will see letter R or letter L. Letter R stands for right side and letter L stands for left side. So in the limb, here you see here, you can see a lead letters, so R and A. This is the right side of the chest and this is the left side of the chest. So what you are seeing here is a sagittal view of a or lateral view. This is the lateral view of an elbow joint. So R stands for which elbow joint? Right elbow joint. So types of radiograph. So we have two types of radiographs. One is a plain X-ray, another is a contrast X-ray. So plain X-ray means what? Here X-rays are taken without injecting a contrast medium. So here the translucent areas appears black, whereas the dense areas appears white. So what you see here is a X-ray chest, PA view. Afterwards, go. X-ray chest. So it is translucent areas black and dense areas white. And this is what you're seeing here is a elbow joint. So this is an elbow joint, both the anterior view and the lateral view. So X-ray lobby. So all can would have seen this lobby in the dissection hall. So this is the lobby where you mount the X-ray film and visualize the and read the X-ray film. So in the hospital setup also you'll be seeing this lobby. You have to mount the X-rays on this lobby and then you have to see it and you have to read the X-rays. So the second type of X-ray is a contrast X-ray. Contrast material introduced into body before taking X-rays. Here X-rays are taken after injecting the contrast material. So this contrast material, it will fill the space or the cavity of the body spots so that it will highlight the cavity or the space of an organ. All oral organs, contrast material are filled and then X-rays are taken. So contrast material, a contrast agent is a substance. What is a contrast material? It is a substance used to increase the contrast of the structures of fluid within the body in medical imaging. Then what are contrast agents? These are commonly used. Why we use it? To improve the visibility of the blood vessels, GIT tract, urinary tract, biliary tract, female reproductive tract and other hollow viscous organs. So contrast materials are of two types. One is opaque. Another is so opaque. In the opaque example is barium sulfate, which is commonly used to visualize the GIT tract. Whereas iodine compounds, all other hollow structures, they are where we use only iodine compounds. Example, urinary tract. So what you are seeing here is a contrast X-ray of the upper GIT. So what you see here, this is a stomach filled with the contrast material and it is the contrast X-ray of a lower GIT. So what you are seeing here is the large intestine filled with the contrast material and this is the small intestine. Again, intravenous pyelogram. So this is a picture of a contrast X-ray of a intravenous pyelogram which is used to study the kidney and the ureters. So here you can see the pelvis of the kidney, a ureter and the bladder, they are filled with the contrast material. And this is a contrast X-ray of a hysterosalpingogram. So here, then the contrast material is injected into the uterus and the fallopian tube. So this is the uterus and this is the fallopian tube. What you see here is a trocar or a cannula, which is used to inject the contrast material. So another material, another contrast material is a translucent. So here, air or oxygen is used. Usually in the olden days, before the invent of this CT and all, what they do in order to study the ventricles of the brain, the surgeons, they inject the air or oxygen. So which we call it as a pneumocephalography. That procedure is called as pneumocephalography. So contrast material, two types of X-rays are there. One is a plain X-ray, another is a contrast X-ray. So plain X-ray, again contrast material, there are two types of contrast material. So what are they? One is the translucent, another is opaque. Okay, so for GIT we use barium sulfate, for all other hollow structures we use iodine compounds. So how a normal skeleton appear in the X-ray? So we'll take the lower bones of a lower limb, a mature bone, otherwise the long bone of an adult, and the outer area is called as a cortex and the inner area is called as the medulla. So here you see this is the tibia and this is the fibula. The cortex area is dense. It is more dense and homogeneously white. Whereas in the center, there is a less denser area showing a series of fine white lines. So this area is called as the medulla. Otherwise, and the bone is called as the lamella or the trabeculae. So outer cortex and inner medulla. Okay, outer cortex and inner medulla. So immature bones. Immature bones. So what you see, previously we saw about the mature bones. So now it is a immature bones. Parts of a developing skeleton or cartilaginous. So these bones will not be visible radiographically. These are called as immature bones. So these immature bones, they will not be visible radiographically, and because they are cartilaginous. So what you are seeing here is a foot of a child, where all the 7 tarsal bones are not seen completely. Radiographic appearance of regions of lower limb. Of the regions of a lower limb. So first we'll see the hip region. So hip region, anteroposterior view. So this is a schematic picture showing the hip region, and this is the corresponding X-ray. This is how the hip region will be seen in the X-rays. Okay. So what are the parts of the hip region here? So this is the ilium bone, and this is the head of the femur. Okay, and this is the acetabulum, and this is the head of the femur. In the ilium, this part is called as the ilium. This is the hip bone, ilium, ischium. This is the pubis, and this is the ischium. Okay, so this is the hip joint. Similarly, you see here. So this is the head of the in the picture. This is the head of the femur, and here this is the head of the femur, and this is the acetabulum. So what you see here is the acetabulum, and this is the ischium, and this is the pubis. And what you are seeing here is the obturator foramen. This is a greater trochanter, and this is a lesser trochanter, and this is the neck of the femur. Okay, so just compare the schematic diagram with the X-ray. Okay. So what is calcar femoral? So there is one terminology you will come across called as calcar femoral. So it is a dense plate of compact bone. Okay, it is a dense plate of compact bone which strengthen the neck shaft angle. So this angle is called as the neck shaft angle. Okay, so this angle is strengthened by a structure called calcar femoral, which is nothing but it is a dense plate of compact bone. So this is the calcar femoral in the X-ray. This is how a calcar femoral appears in the X-ray. What is Shenton's line? So one more line is a Shenton's line. So this dotted line is called as a Shenton's line. It indicates normal relation of a head of the femur with the acetabulum. So this we call it as a Shenton's line. So this dotted line. So if the Shenton's line is intact, then it indicates that the normal relation of a head of the femur with the acetabulum. So that's all about the hip region. Now we move on to the knee region. So AP view, this is a schematic diagram, and this is the how the X-ray picture. So R stands here, R stands for right knee joint. So R stands for right knee joint. So what are the structures you see in the picture? So this is the patella, and this is the intercondylar notch of the femur. So this is the lateral condyle of the femur, and this is a medial condyle of the femur. Similarly, lateral and medial condyle of the tibia, and this is the head of the fibula. So this is the intercondylar eminence which is seen on the upper surface of the tibia. This space is called as the knee joint space. So simultaneously you apply this in this picture. So what is this? So this is the patella. Yes, this is the patella. This is the patella, and these are the condyles. So condyles of the femur, condyles of the tibia. And what is this? This is the head of the fibula, and this is the intercondylar eminence of the tibia. So this is how you have to correlate simultaneously with the schematic picture and read. So lateral view. So two views. One we saw previous view is the anterior view. Now we see about the lateral view. So we are seeing the knee joint from the lateral aspect. So patella will be anterior, okay, and this is the joint space, and this is head of the fibula again, and intercondylar eminence you will see as a projection upwards. This is a lateral condyle, and this is a medial condyle of the femur. So you see here. So just apply this in the picture. This is what? This is a patella, and what is this? This is a lower end of the femur. This is the lateral condyle, and this will be, this arc will be your medial condyle. And this, you can see an eminence here. So this is the intercondylar eminence of the tibia. So this is the head of the fibula, and this is the condyles of the tibia. So now we move on to the ankle. Ankle AP view. So AP view, this is the lower end. So lower end of the tibia, and this is the lower end of the fibula. This we call it as a condyles. Okay, this projections are, we call it as a malleolus. So this is a lateral malleolus from the fibula, and the medial malleolus from the tibia. And this space is called as the ankle joint space. Below is the talus. So you apply this in this X-ray picture. So this is the lower end of the fibula, this is the lower end of the tibia and this gap. So what you are seeing here is a ankle joint gap and this bone is called as the talus. Foot. So foot, AP view. So this is a schematic picture of the foot, AP view, and this is the X-ray picture of the AP view of the foot. Okay. So this tarsal bones, you can see the tarsal bones, metatarsal bones and the phalanges. Here also these are the phalanges. Okay. So these are the phalanges and so this is the distal phalanx and this is the middle phalanx. Okay. Distal, middle and proximal phalanges, and what you are seeing here, these are the metacarpals. So numbering always it should be done from the great toe, that is from the medial to the lateral side. So this is the first metacarpal and this is the fifth metatarsal. So this is the first metatarsal and this is the fifth metatarsal. What you are seeing here, two bulge on the first metatarsal, head of the first metatarsal. So these are the sesamoid bones. Okay. So these are the sesamoid bones which develop in the head of the first metatarsal, and these are the tarsal bones. So how many tarsal bones we have? Seven. So we have seven tarsal bones. So calcaneum, talus, okay, cuboid, navicular, three cuneiform. So these are the tarsal bones you are seeing here. This is how the foot will appear in AP view. So let's see the ankle and foot in the lateral view. So how they look in the lateral view. So this is a schematic picture and this is the lateral view of the foot, ankle joint and the foot. So this is the lower end of the tibia and just deep to it you will see a slim structure, that is the fibula, and this space is called as the joint space, that is an ankle joint space. So this dome shaped structure is the talus. Okay. And in front of the talus is a navicular, this is the calcaneum which is projecting backwards to form the heel of the foot, and in front of the calcaneum is the cuboid. So this orientation you can understand, no? What are the uses of an X-ray? Why we need to take this X-rays? Okay. So one, to diagnose the fracture, or one, to confirm the fracture. So in the first picture, what you are seeing, which bone is got fractured? It is a shaft of the humerus. Okay. Here in the second picture, it is a neck of the femur. So the first one is a shaft of the femur. Second is the neck of the femur. So what is this fracture? It is the intertrochanteric fracture of the femur. So between the two trochanters, there is a fracture. So intertrochanteric fracture, all these fractures, neck of fractures are very common in the elderly. Okay. So again, you are seeing here the fractures of both the bones of the leg, both the tibia and the fibula, they got fractured and displaced. So one is an anterior view, another is a lateral view. And this X-ray shows the fracture of the fifth metatarsal. So fifth, fourth and third. So three metatarsal bones got fractured. What is this bone? What you are seeing on the head of the first metatarsal? So it is a sesamoid bone. Yes, it is a sesamoid bone. Then second one, to diagnose or to confirm dislocations. So dislocation. So you see here the head of, during dislocation, what happens? The head of the femur, it comes out. So it comes out of the, displaced out of the acetabulum. So this is the anterior dislocation of left. So you can see here, this is the right hip joint and this is the left hip joint. So in the left hip joint, you see the head of the femur, it has come downwards. So and lies anterior. So this we call it as an anterior dislocation of left femur head. So what is here? This is a posterior dislocation of hip. So this is the right hip. You see here, the head of the right femur, it is pushed upwards and backwards. So this is a posterior, this is how a posterior dislocation of the hip appears, and this is the acetabulum. So what you see here is the acetabulum is empty. Then we move on to the knee joint dislocation. So you see here, here the femur is dislocated anteriorly and the tibia is posteriorly. Similarly here, what happens, you see here, so here the femur, it is dislocated. Here it is milder form, it is severe form. It has come and lying in front of the tibia, behind the tibia. So this is anterior dislocation of femur. This is posterior dislocation of femur. Ankle fractures, so anterior dislocations. So this is a picture showing the fracture. So what you're seeing here, so all this, you see the lower end of the tibia has broken, and also this tarsal bones also got broken. Here you can see the fracture. So here again you see here, this is the, which malleolus is this? Medial malleolus. So mere fracture of the medial malleolus and also the shaft of the fibula. Okay, so the third use is the assess the bone age. So we can assess the bone age. So this is the hip joint of a child at birth. So where you will not have the, you will not find the head of the femur. So this is the X-ray of a child at 1 year. So where you cannot see all the tarsal bones. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, only 4 are there. Then to confirm the diagnosis, bone infection. So infection of a bone is called as the osteomyelitis. So you can see a osteolytic lesion here. So this is how an infectious site in the bone looks, appears in the X-ray. Then to confirm the bone tumors. So bone tumors like osteoma, osteoclastoma, it can be benign tumors or malignant tumors. So that tumors can also be confirmed by X-rays, osteoma, osteoclastoma and osteosarcoma. So osteoma, this is tibia. So in the here, we'll see the osteoma in the tibia. Osteoclastoma is in the femur, lower end of the femur. Osteosarcoma of the femur, you see here, this is the bone and also the muscle surrounding the bone is also involved. So that is why we call it this as a osteosarcoma. So how to read an X-ray? So how to read an X-ray? So whenever an X-ray is given to you, you have to read in this order. First, you have to tell what type of X-ray, whether it's a plane or contrast X-ray. Then what, in what view it is taken, whether AP view, PA view, lateral or oblique view. Which region is taken, shoulder region, elbow region, hip region, chest region, that you should mention. Then you have to describe the bony features and the soft tissue features. And you also have to learn to mount the X-rays in the X-ray lobby. So when you go to the dissection hall next time, you get an X-ray, everyone should learn to mount the X-rays in the X-ray lobby. So that's all about the radiological anatomy. Then we move on to our surface anatomy. So surface anatomy. Introduction. What is surface anatomy? It is a study of the position of the deeper structures in relationship with the skin surface of the body. So during a dissection and all, what you do in cadaver, we can dissect the, we can peel the skin and we can see the deeper structures. But in living individuals, we cannot do so. So that we can read with the help of a surface anatomy. So how we study? With the help of a landmarks. So landmarks are of two types. One is visible, another is palpable. So visible means it is understood that the structures are, the landmarks are visible to the naked eye. Whereas palpable, it is not visible to naked eye, but it has to, it can be felt by palpation. So visible landmarks, so it is seen on inspection. Examples, bony prominences, all the body bony prominences produced by bones and cartilages and also nipple and umbilicus. Palpable landmarks, it is felt through the skin. It is not visible, but it is felt through the skin. Examples, muscles and tendons. Arteries, nerves, spermatic cord, parotid duct. Okay, muscles and tendons, arteries, nerves, spermatic cord and parotid duct. So muscles and tendons, you should make and make the muscle to contract and then you can make it obvious. Similarly, arteries, the pulsation can be felt. Nerves, so the muscles are, we can roll the nerves against the bone and you can feel. For example, in the upper limb, you can feel the ulnar nerve behind the medial epicondyle. Similarly, in the lower limb, so the common peroneal nerve will be winding around the neck of the fibula, so where you can feel. So in male spermatic cord, in both the sexes, parotid duct can be felt. It is not seen, but it can be felt. So surface landmarks in the gluteal region. So this is a, what you see here, this is the iliac crest. So 5 cm behind the anterior superior iliac spine will be a tubercle called as the crest of, tubercle of the iliac crest. So and this is anterior superior iliac spine and this is a posterior superior iliac spine. So what you see here is a ischial tuberosity and this is a greater trochanter. Okay, so this is a greater trochanter. So one triangle, so Nelaton's line, you will come across a line called Nelaton's line which passes from the ischial tuberosity to the anterior superior iliac spine. And this is a triangle called the Bryant's triangle. Okay, so this triangle is called as the Bryant's triangle. So Nelaton's line, you have seen in this. This line is drawn from anterior superior iliac spine to the ischial tuberosity with patients in supine position. So normally the tip of the greater trochanter lies on or below this line. So it has to lie on or below this line. So second is the Bryant's triangle. Bryant's triangle, it measures the supratrochanteric shortening of the hip. That is, if there is a shortening, we have to suspect fracture of the femur head or neck. So that is the clinical significance of these two Mellitus and Nellitus line and your Brien's triangle. So Brien's triangle, it measures the supratrochanteric shortening of the hip. Then surface landmark of front of thigh. So what are the things you have to see in the front of thigh? One is the, you should know is the anterior superior iliac spine. Then comes your pubic tubercle, and this area is called as the pubic symphysis. Okay. So this region is called as the inguinal region. So here, which is, it gives attachment to the inguinal ligament. So two things you have to remember here. So otherwise is commonly called as the groin. So two things are the midpoint of inguinal ligament and mid inguinal point. Okay. So midpoint of inguinal ligament is the midpoint between your anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic tubercle. So mid inguinal point is anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic symphysis. Okay, so it is a pubic symphysis. So among the two points, midpoint of inguinal ligament is lateral, whereas your mid inguinal point is medial. So here in the lower part, you will see that is near the ankle joint, you will see an adductor tubercle, which is on the posterior surface of the medial side of the medial condyle, okay, to which a tendon of the adductor magnus gets attached. So surface landmarks in the leg. So it is the lower end of the femur, that is your lateral condyle, medial condyle, then comes your patella, then comes the knee joints, then the condyles of the tibia. So lateral and medial condyles of the tibia, head of the fibula. Then on the anterior surface, we have a tibial tubercle, and there is a sharp margin, anterior margin of the tibia, which we call it as a shin. And this is the medial surface of the tibia, which is, and this is a lateral surface. So in the lower limb near the ankle, we have a medial malleolus and the lateral malleolus. Medial malleolus by the tibia and lateral malleolus formed by the fibula. So surface landmarks of the foot on the medial side. So what are the landmarks you will say? One is the medial malleolus. So we'll see the medial malleolus, head of the talus we can feel, and the tendon of the tibialis anterior. Okay. So there is a shelf-like projection. So which we call it as a, from the talus, we call it as a sustentaculum tali. So what are the surface landmarks of the lateral side of the foot? It is a lateral malleolus. Okay. Head of the talus and then the peroneal tubercle. So near this metatarsal, we'll see a tubercle of the fifth metatarsal. So these are the bony landmarks which are seen on the foot on the lateral side. So femoral artery. First, we'll see about the vessels and nerves. How to trace the vessels and nerves? Femoral artery. So first point will be where? So it will be in the mid inguinal point. Second point, adductor tubercle. Okay, join these two points. That gives the approximate location of the artery. So then femoral artery continues as popliteal artery. So the first point will be at the junction of the upper two-third and the lower one-third of the thigh. The second point will be in the midline of the back of knee. And the third point will be midline of the back of leg at tibial tuberosity level. So join all these three lines, you will get the approximate location of your popliteal artery, which is in the popliteal fossa. Then dorsalis pedis artery. So dorsalis pedis artery, first point will be here, midway between the two malleolus, that is the medial and the lateral malleolus. Second point will be from the proximal end of the first intermetatarsal space. So proximal end of the first intermetatarsal space. Join these two points and unite these points by a parallel line. So that gives the approximate location of the dorsalis pedis artery. Then we move on to one great vein, one important vein in the leg, that is your great saphenous vein. So the first point will be in the medial end of the dorsal venous arch. Then the vein ascends upwards in front of the medial malleolus, 2.5 cm lateral to medial malleolus. So this is the second point. Then third point, it ascends along the medial border of the tibia. Fourth point, adductor tubercle. So then it passes through the adductor tubercle. So fifth point, then it ascends upwards. So what happens here, this great saphenous vein, it ascends along the medial side of the leg, then it goes posteriorly again in the thigh, it enters on the medial side of the thigh and it ascends upwards towards the saphenous opening. It pierces the cribriform fascia and finally it opens into the femoral vein. So the next structure, so far we have seen about the blood vessels. Now we are seeing about the sciatic nerves. Now we move on to the sciatic nerve. So sciatic nerve, which we see on the posterior aspect of the thigh. The first point will be 2.5 cm lateral midpoint of the line joining the posterior superior iliac spine and the ischial tuberosity. The second point, medial to midpoint of line joining ischial tuberosity and the apex of greater trochanter. So the third point will be is a supralateral angle of the popliteal fossa. Join all these three points, that gives the approximate location of the sciatic nerve. So this is the first point, this is the second point, and this is the third point. So then comes your deep peroneal nerve. So deep peroneal nerve, first point will be lateral aspect of the neck of the fibula. Second point, front of the ankle between two malleoli. Join these two points, that gives the approximate location of the deep peroneal nerve, which is the nerve of the anterior compartment of leg. Then superficial peroneal nerve, it is a nerve of the lateral compartment. It is a nerve of the lateral compartment of the leg. As usual, the first point will be the lateral aspect of the neck of the fibula. And the second point will be in the anterior aspect of the leg, just above the point of the ankle. That is the first point of the deep peroneal nerve. So join these two points, it gives the approximate location of the superficial peroneal nerve, which is the nerve of the lateral compartment of leg. So we have seen, so in the surface anatomy, we have seen the surface, we have drawn the surface anatomy for arteries, veins and nerves, important nerves. So thank you so much for your patient listening. So any doubt you can ask in the next session. Thank you so much.